there is this story of the camel pot, the blanket wearers, and they were deeply, deeply spiritual men and women, and they were called the blanket wearers because their only possession was one blanket which they wore about them as a covering during the day and used as a blanket at night. And the story goes that they went from prophet to prophet, looking, seeking, and they never found the answer they were looking for. And according to this tradition, there was one day when the prophet, peace be upon him, was with his companions. And he said, in so many days, so many of these, the camel posh are coming. And lo and behold, in that time they arrived. And he didn't say anything to them. And they were completely satisfied and they stayed with him. Why were they completely satisfied? Because he created love in their hearts. And if you create love in somebody's heart, they are completely fulfilled as human beings. They want nothing more, except more love, of course. And so from that meeting, this hidden esoteric aspect grew, flourished, until it went all over the Middle East, to India, to Indonesia, and then in the last century came to the West and to America.
This tradition appears in history at a certain moment, and it comes very definitely out of the context of the Islamic revelation and the integration of that revelation on the part of deep seekers who seek to realize the mysteries, the deeper dimensions of the revelation, not satisfied merely to fulfill the outer form, but striving to seek the mystical depth. But of course, the search for mystical depth is a perennial one, an ancient one. That search has been the search of human beings all throughout history. So in the sense that Sufism is a search for a deeper meaning, a truer engagement with the purpose of life, in that sense, Sufism is absolutely universal and is the essence of the revelations of all of the prophets.
Sufism is just the experience of. You want direct knowledge of God. You want communication with God. You want a nearness to God.
Separate, the feeling of separation from the essence of our being is the source of all suffering. And so we want to have a path of mysticism which helps guide people to find their own inner being, their own inner joy. For me, Sufism isn't owned by any religion, by any particular shape. It's the fragrance of the heart. In the West, in the East, in any plane, wherever existence manifests, there needs to be some guidance to allow us to overcome the false notion of separateness and to recognize our true nature.
They say that mysticism is the via negativa. One becomes less and less and less until finally, as in the words of the Christian mystic John Ruysbroeck, one is drawn into the dark silence in which all lovers lose themselves. You become less and less and less. It is as simple as that. You can say you are being drowned in love, or you lose yourself. These are just words, these are just suggestions, but say the Sufi says you have to become less than the dust at the feet of the teacher. You know nothing, you are nothing. You become just emptiness, finally. Destroyed by love. Sufis call it fana, annihilated by love. Lost in love. Lost in the company of those who are lost in God.
It happens in the heart. It doesn't happen in the breast. And so a lot of people think that they're in their heart, but they're not. They still have a dynamic within themselves where they're working with resistance and surrender. They still have what I call shadow and light. When you're in your heart, things change. It's very different. It's a very living, dynamic experience. You feel this.
There has to be a confusion when we recognize that every single relative reality, including everything and not excluding anything, is the manifestation of that incorruptible, unchanged ultimate, that everything is God. But then we have to ask, well, how do we practice the path of the lover? If there's only one, how is there two? And so the Sufis beautifully say that the beloved is all, the lover is just a veil. And so if you practice love well, you overcome the thought of self. The thought of what you love fills up the heart. The veil of the lover disappears, and there's only a beloved.
There is a polish for every rust, and the polish for the heart is dhikr Allah, is remembrance of God.
We shouldn't be confused. You can't confine the all-pervading reality, which is hidden and present, to a name. So God can't have any name or has to have every name without question. But then by making certain sounds with your physical body, with your thoughts, and with your feeling, you evoke a state of consciousness which is more transparent and allows you to look more deeply into that which is the source of your being.
The word Allah embraces two core concepts: to do something and something else. One thing, and Pierre Zia reminded me of Pierre Shibley, Yo Qadasallah, it's to go mad. It's to go insane. It's to go nuts. The other core concept is to fall in love. In other words, not just to fall in love, but madly in love. It's to go nuts with passion. It's to go insane with desire. But it's not just enough to say that God is ma'shuq, the beloved. There must be this element of madness, irrationality in there to really capture that word. It has to encompass both those notions, or you just won't get it. So it's dynamic, it's verbal, and it's both passionate and insane. It's to go out of one's mind with desire. Sheikh Llewellyn talked about that edge of madness also. There's an edge of madness, and there is much, much passion and drama and the heat and fire and light of love. If you just understand that much about Allah, you might not just say Allah, you might say Allah. Oh, oh, oh. Oh.
This is this other dimension of love, which is a love based upon oneness. And in fact, the Sufis say not when you don't need an ocean, you just need one sip of this love. They call it the wine of divine love. And you are intoxicated, you are lost forever. You just want one more sip because it is so potent, it is so powerful. It is, our Sheikh, he said, love is the greatest force in the universe. And it is unbelievably beautiful. And yes, it creates burning in the heart, it creates desire, it creates longing for God. And it also creates tremendous states of intimacy, of nearness, of a love that fills every cell of your body until you are saturated in love and takes you really from the world of duality, from the world of you and me, across the infinite ocean to the further shores of love, which is a place of oneness in which I am he whom I love is me. And that is one of the great esoteric secrets of the Sufis, how to use love to transform a human being, how to take them from the world of duality into the ocean of oneness, into the intimacies of the heart.
Sufism is about intimacy and nearness. In this poem that was given to me, in the silence of the night comes the unknown she whispering sweetly, come dance with me. There is so much in those few sentences. If you look at, you know, the metaphysics of this, it's a very subtle relationship. It's like a whisper. You know, there's this implied nearness, this intimacy, you know, a dance. You know, you're going to have to get engaged. And that's one of the things in the West that I find people have a real difficult time with, is to actually make contact and then stay engaged. It's a transformation.
The Sufi faces a dilemma, and this has been articulated by Sheikh al-Akbar ibn al-Arabi, when he says the lover is in a dilemma because love has two imperatives. One is that the lover desires union with the beloved. The lover wants nothing more than just to forget himself, herself, and completely merge into the being of the beloved, and never to be apart, never to be separate, just to be fully immersed in the beloved. That is one imperative of love. But then Ibn al-Arabi reminds us there is another imperative of love, and that is that the lover wishes to respect the will of the beloved. So if the lover wants union, but if the beloved wants separation, then the lover must be prepared to sacrifice, to renounce his or her own desire in favor of God's desire. So that is what is meant by the renunciation of renunciation. Tarke tark. Renunciation of what is otherwise the object of the mystic quest, unio mystica, to leave it for God's sake, because God is invested in this world.
Yes, there is a tradition of what the Sufis call the awliya, the friends of God. And these are spiritual beings who look after the spiritual well-being of the world. There's actually a early Sufi, Al-Hakim al-Tirmidhi, he was one of the first Sufis to write about this. And he said, really, the crops cannot grow, the seasons cannot flourish without the presence in both invisible and the visible worlds of these spiritual masters. It is an esoteric secret, really, that until recently hasn't been made known, that there are these spiritual beings who look after the well-being of the world. you know, Sufis, we hold the mysteries of divine love. Maybe that is the simplest, maybe that is the most potent, that there is this substance in life called love, and it is the greatest power in the universe, and it can move mountains and it can move hearts. And mostly it is veiled from humanity, but we are the guardians of the secrets of love. And